Good morning. Welcome to worship. We are glad to have with us today Dr. Joey McNeil, former pastor of Fort Trial Baptist Church, and his wife Darlene, partner in ministry all these many years. He will be bringing our message today, and we're thankful for you being here and joining us in worship today. Let's have a word of prayer before we begin and start our worship. Lord God, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for your promises. We thank you for the knowledge that you are here among us. We pray that you would just help us in this time to set aside all other worries, to set aside other concerns, to focus our hearts and minds on your greatness, your love, your mercy, and to be renewed by being in the presence of our God. We ask these things, Lord. We pray that you would give us open hearts and minds and that you would help us to worship you, for you are worthy of our praise. We ask these things, Lord, and offer you that praise in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. I invite you to stand as we join and sing together, Jesus Messiah. He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and he carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. His body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. All I hope is in you, all I hope. The glory to you, God, the light of the world, Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all.
Before the world was made, before you spoke it to be, you were the King of Kings. Yeah, you were, and now you're reigning still, enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out, we join them as we sing. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Creator God, you gave me breath so I could praise your great and matchless name all my days, so let my whole life be a blazing offering, a life that shouts and sings the greatness of our King. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my life and let it be yours. Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my life and let it be yours. Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my life and let it be yours. Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my life and let it be yours. We sing glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever.
Sometimes we live life in the middle of a storm, left out in the open, exposed to the elements. No matter where we look, protection seems miles away. Shelter feels out of reach. Lately, these storms have grown stronger, more intense, more difficult to bear. Where do we look when we can't see the way forward? How do we find safe harbor? In the midst of the ebb and flow, God promises to be our refuge and our strength, our ever-present help in times of trouble. In our most desperate moments, we can rest safely behind the rock of our salvation. Protected by the shadow of His wing. Yes, life has its troubles, but our God is a mighty fortress, our stronghold, our refuge.
We call the place where we come to worship sanctuary. Not because these bricks or walls are any different from any other as far as how they're made, but because this is where we come to bring our praise to God, to bring our request, to hear His word, and to share together as brothers and sisters in Christ. And it's a reminder to us that our sanctuary is found nowhere else but Him. And there is no other place we need look. I invite you to join me in prayer. Lord, we thank You for being a God who is greater than the storms that we face. We thank You for the love that You pour out on us through all seasons of life. We thank You for the promises that You will be with us in all things and through all things, and that we are safe in Your hands as Your children, no matter the storms that blow, no matter the trials that come our way, that after these times of testing, we will be with You. And Lord, until that day, we pray that You would just give us brave hearts, steady feet, and eyes that stay on the prize as we make our way home to You. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I invite you to once again stand as we continue worshiping our Lord.
Lord, I come to You, let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in You. Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be stripped away by the power of Your love. Hold me close, let Your love surround me, bring me near, draw me to Your side. And as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with You. Your Spirit leads me on by the power of Your love. Lord, unveil my eyes, let me see You face to face, the knowledge of Your love as You live in me. Lord, renew my mind as Your will unfolds in my life, in living every day by the power of Your love. Hold me close, let Your love surround me, bring me near, draw me to Your side. And as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with You. Your Spirit leads me on by the power of Your love. And I will soar with You. Your Spirit leads me on by the power of Your love.
One heart, one spirit, one voice to praise you. We are the body of Christ. One goal, one vision, to see you exalted. We are the body of Christ, and to this we give our lives, to see you glorified. One heart, one spirit, one voice to praise you. We are the body of Christ. One goal, one vision, to see you exalted. We are the body of Christ, and to this we give our lives, to see you glorified. One heart, one spirit, one voice to praise you. We are the body of Christ. Dr. McNeil, we invite you to come share the word with us now this morning.
Well, good morning. It's good to see you and good to be with you again. I certainly hope Mike gets better and improves, and we'll be back with you. Appreciate David and Mike, their ministry here, and you as well. This morning, I'm going to read a passage from the book of Romans, chapter 15, and verses 1 through 7, as we share from God's word this morning. And think about an overlooked obligation, an overlooked obligation. From Romans chapter 15, verses 1 through 7. Now we who are strong ought to bear the weaknesses of those without strength and not just please ourselves. Or I like the way the English Standard Version puts that, that we who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak, and not to please ourselves. Let each of us please his neighbor for his good, to build him up. And then verse 2, each of us is to please his neighbor for his good, to his edification. For even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me. For whatever was written in earlier times was written for our instruction, so that through perseverance and the encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope. Now may the God who gives perseverance and encouragement grant you to be of the same mind with one another according to Christ Jesus, so that with one accord you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore accept one another, just as Christ also accepted us, to the glory of God. You know, a couple of weeks ago I got this text from your pastor, asking about preaching today. And of course, my reply to him, as I looked at my calendar and saw it's clear, my reply to him was, of course, I'd be glad to do it, be honored to do it, and be here on this Sunday for these services at 9 and 11. Of course, when I said yes, and I wrote that on my calendar, at that very moment, I had an obligation to be here this morning with you. A commitment to fulfill and to preach and to bring the morning message. An obligation. You know, we all have obligations. If we stop and think about our obligations, sometimes it can be overwhelming, can't it? In life, we have many moments where we come across and have those obligations. The obligation to report to our job, for those still working out in various jobs. The obligation to report to school for students and teachers as well, of course. The obligation to pay debts. That's the one we wish we didn't have, but, you know, when we borrow money or we purchase something, we have the obligation to pay that debt, to pay what we owe. And obligations to keep promises. How many promises in our life have we made to other people? And when we make a promise, at that moment, we have an obligation, a commitment to keep that promise. But when we come to Scripture and study all that it teaches about being a disciple of Christ, we can read about various obligations that we have if we're to be a follower of Christ. Jesus spoke about those. In Luke 9:23, he defined it in this way: if anyone would be my disciple, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. He also spoke of the obligation to love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbor as ourselves, to love one another. And those are obligations that we hear most, aren't they? To love one another, to follow Christ, to deny self, take up our cross daily, and follow him. But in this passage we read today, we come across an obligation that Paul speaks about that I would say we gets overlooked, or maybe forgotten. The obligation, as Paul defines it there in the very first verse, to bear with the failings of the weak. To bear with the failings of the weak. Now that certainly is tied to loving God and loving one another, and there's a lot that could be said about that. In fact, as I read that passage, it just, you know, I've read it, I'm sure I've read that passage before. I don't know if I've ever preached on this passage before. I meant to look in my file before I came to check that out. But it just stood out to me, that first verse, that we have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak. And there's much more that he says about that in those verses. But as we do that, it's important to point out that Paul's really continuing a conversation that he started in Romans 14. And sometime go back and read Romans 14, because there was a problem in the church at Rome. There were those that believed that, you know, you need to strictly observe all the laws, all the dietary laws and the laws of the Sabbath. And some, you know, you just be a vegetarian and don't eat any meat or whatever it might be. And then there were others that said, you know, really, for a Christian, all that's really irrelevant. And so there was sort of a conflict there. It was creating problems, and some are being critical of others because of their faults and their beliefs. And it was creating a lot of problems. So Paul begins in chapter 14. He speaks to that. In fact, if you look in chapter 14 and look in verses 10 through 13, there Paul is calling for a different attitude on the part of the Christians. His teaching is a call to grace with one another. It's a call on the stronger brothers and sisters not to attack with continual criticism those with whom they even disagreed, but to realize that they had a common vision, a common mission, proclaiming the gospel, a common mission of glorifying God. And so he calls for a different attitude. And in Romans 14, 10 through 13, he says, "But you, why do you judge your brother? Or you again, why do you regard your brother with contempt? For we all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each one of us will give an account of himself to God. Therefore, let us not judge one another anymore, but rather determine this, not to put an obstacle or a stumbling block in a brother's way." You know, I think it's really appropriate for us to reflect on this obligation that Paul speaks of, especially in this day and time of so much negativity and divisiveness in culture and even in some churches. But in light of this, as we think about Jesus bearing with our failings, and Paul points that out in Romans 15, he gives Jesus as the example, who has borne our failings on the cross, dying for our sin. And so this obligation that Paul speaks of is the obligation that we have to bear with one another and with the failings of the weak, or to bear the weaknesses of those who have no strength, without strength. And so you might be wondering, well, how do you do that? And that's what I wonder. When I read that passage and I looked at it and I read it, I said, well, what does it mean to bear with the failings of the weak? And as you think about that and answer that question, the beginning of the answer is found in the very next part of the verse when he says, "Those now we who are strong have an obligation to bear with the weaknesses of the failings or the weaknesses of the weak." He says, and not just to please ourselves. We can't look over that phrase, not just to please ourselves, because that really gives us the key to where we have to start to bear with the failings of those around us, of the weak. And you say, wait a minute, does that seem like they're setting up a superiority and inferiority complex? No, that's why that next phrase is there. And not to please ourselves. You see, it starts with recognizing our own failings and our own sin. Jesus talked about that in Matthew 7, 1 through 5. You know those verses in the Sermon on the Mount where he says, "Judge not, lest you be judged, for with the judgment you judge, you will be judged." And then he goes on to say, "And why are you looking at the splinter in your brother's eye, your sister's eye, and not seeing the log in your own eye?" I like what one Martin translation says. Why are you looking at the splinters in your brother's eye and you don't see the 2x4 in your own eye? So Jesus is speaking to this attitude that we need to look at our own lives and look at our own failings and our own weaknesses. Paul also addresses this in Galatians chapter 6 in verses 1 through 5 when he says, "Brethren, if anyone is caught in a trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, each one looking to yourself so that you too will not be tempted. Bear one another's burdens and therefore fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he's something when he's nothing, he deceives himself. But each one must examine his own work. And then he will have reason for boasting in regard to himself alone and not in regard to another." So Paul's saying, as we confess our own faults, as we recognize our own sin, as we recognize the struggles that we have, as we recognize our own failings, as we recognize our own attitudes that maybe don't glorify Christ and certainly don't show love and kindness to others, then Paul says we need to start with us. And then as we do that, as we look at ourselves, and then we're better able to see others through the lens of our own failings and our own sin and our own weaknesses, and to be able to walk with and to bear with others who are facing struggles in their own life. We need to have the attitude, "Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner," instead of the attitude, "Lord, thank goodness I'm not like that person. Thank goodness I'm not like him or like her." And so as we confess and recognize our own failings, then we have the heart attitude that helps us to bear with others. It gives us a different vision of others. So Paul's saying here, is we who are strong, not to please ourselves, is to keep proper perspective of who we are, in our own needs, and our own sin, and our own failings. And as we do that, we're able to see others in a different light. When I was pastor in Lancaster, and of course I know that there are other type facilities like this around the country and in Virginia and in our area, but in Lancaster there was a place called the Lancaster Recovery Center, and it was a place where those who were suffering and dealing with addictions in their life would go, whether it be alcohol or drugs, and they would go there. And but it was interesting because the staff of that facility, the majority of the staff, especially the counselors and those who dealt directly with those struggling with addiction, were those who had recovered from addictions themselves. They had walked that road. They had seen what it was to be addicted and to have those struggles. And so they were able, because they recognized what it's like, they recognized what the struggle is and their own weakness and their own failings and how they got through it, and they were able to bear with others as they sought to get through it. That's really the spirit that we need to have. that we see others through Christ's eyes. So to answer that question, how are we to bear with the failings of the weak, is we need to realize we're the weak, and we have failings, and to see ourselves in that light. And then the second thing that verse points out is that it's not to please ourselves, but let us each please his neighbor for his good to build him up. In other words, Paul's saying we need to relate redemptively for the good of others. That's what he wanted the people in the church at Rome to do, were having these disagreements and having this strife. He wanted them to see each other in a different light and to realize, to please, to do good, to show grace and mercy to one another, to build them up in Christ. This doesn't mean that we look the other way. It doesn't mean that we compromise morals or what God's Word teaches. And that's not what Paul's saying. It's not having a holier-than-thou attitude. William Barclay, in his commentary on this passage, expresses it this way. He says, it's not the toleration which tolerates because it's too lazy to do anything else. It's the toleration which knows that a man or woman may be won much more easily to a fuller faith by surrounding him or her with love than by attacking with a battery of criticism. Speaking the truth in love. Dale Moody, who was a professor many, many moons ago at Southern Seminary, said, those who are truly strong put love above both conscience and knowledge and imitate Christ. That's what Paul says in verses 3 and 4. He said, you know, Christ has given us an example. He says, Christ didn't please himself. He bore our sin, our reproach on himself so that we could have hope. And that we could know him. But how many times have we criticized the failings of others? Maybe even rejoiced over them. How many times when someone doesn't live up to our expectations do we sort of mark them off our list of friends or relationship? The goal of bearing with is a redemptive goal. We do it for the good of our neighbor, to build them up, to see others as Christ sees them, to do so, as I said, speaking the truth in love. I have a younger brother, and some years ago, he was dealing with a lot of stuff in his life, and a lot of sadness and sorrow, and it led to some drug addiction and spent time in jail. Some very stressful, straining moments for our family, especially for my mom in South Carolina. But as we saw him walk through that, we did our best to bear with him. It was hard. There were some times you're angry. Sometimes you're frustrated, sometimes you grieved, and sometimes you wondered, will he ever get out of this? But you know, and my mom set the ultimate example. We didn't strike him off the list, being our brother, but we kept praying. We kept loving him, even when it was not displayed in return. And God heard those prayers. And some years later, he went to a facility in Boone, North Carolina, and the Lord really turned his life around. And today he's working. He's also does a volunteer ministry in a prison with Kairos, a ministry to prisoners and their families. But what would have happened if we would have just struck him off the list? If we would not have borne with his failings at that moment? But we loved and we continued. Yes, to speak the truth in love. We weren't happy. We wanted him to do better. And thank goodness, thank the Lord, God worked and moved and changed his life. You see, that's the goal of our bearing, is not to win an argument, not to prove I'm right and you're wrong, but the goal is redemptive and reconciliation. And we do it for the good of our neighbor, to build them up and to display the love of Christ. And the result of it is a spirit of worship. Paul says in verse 5, "Now may the God who gives perseverance and encouragement grant you to be of the same mind with one another according to Christ Jesus, so that with one accord, with one heart, one spirit, you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." Our worship is more meaningful. We come together, and you know, as we worship God, think of that picture. Even this morning, that we're here this morning worshiping God, and we all have our weaknesses. We all have our failings. We all have our needs. We all have our struggles. And that's the beauty of the church as she ought to be, that as we worship, that we come together in that spirit, and we, as a fellowship of fellow strugglers, in the presence of God, and we share, knowing that Christ was broken for our brokenness. And because of that, we can come together and worship. We can come together and experience His grace and know that His grace is sufficient and it's made perfect and complete in our weakness. We're reminded of our own failings. And we bow before the one who died that we might live, to see our own hearts as God sees us. And you know, when we do that, when we see our hearts first as God sees us and we look at the splinters in our own eye, it sure gives us a different perspective as we look at others. During my college days, I worked at Garden City Chapel and Retreat. And one of the things that we did, and the pastor at that time, who's since passed away, Hal Norton, would put together trips for children's homes. And there were two or three specific children's homes that he would take. And one of them happened to be Patrick Henry Boys Home at that time up near Brookneal, Virginia. And we would go on these trips. We'd take them to Disney World, take them to do different fun things like that. People would contribute money to cover the cost of all that. The kids didn't have to pay a dime. And we would go and help chaperone. And a part of that was being assigned a couple of the kids. And I was assigned a couple of the boys, younger boys. And one of them was a rascal. I just thought before that week was out that I just didn't know if I was going to survive. He just got under my skin. And it was interesting, though, after a couple of days, Mr. Norton, in a conversation, just he and I, he asked me. And I don't know if he perceived that I was having a struggle with this kid or not, but he asked me, he says, "Now, which one of those boys that you're looking after this week do you have the hardest time, most difficult time loving?" And I didn't have to wait to answer. I answered right away. And I told him who it was. It was Billy. And he said, "Do you know anything about him?" And I said, "No, sir." And then he began to tell his story. Mr. Norton related how he'd grown up with an alcoholic father who physically and emotionally abused him, and a mom who didn't care, and so finally he became a kid with really no family, with all sorts of wounds and pain in his life, and he was only 7 or 8 years old. And already had a life of experience, a lifetime of hurt. By the time he got through telling me that story, I had to do some confessing and repenting myself, as I realized my attitude toward him was really hindering me from really ministering to him. And it changed my perspective. It changed my view and vision of that little boy. And the rest of the week, yeah, he still sort of got on your skin at times, but I sure dealt with it in a different way. I was able to bear with little Billy's failings and difficulties in a much better way because I was able to see through different lens. I think that's what Paul's trying to say, at least from my perspective as I look at this passage. is that we as the body of Christ need to be one in Christ, worshiping Christ, glorifying Him. But as we do that, there are going to be times that we're going to fail one another. There are going to be times where we're going to be tempted to strike folks off our list because of their failings, whatever they might be. They may be a moral failing. It may be a personal thing. But Paul challenges us in our faith, in our love, in our following of Christ to fulfill the obligation to bear with the failings of the weak, not to pump ourselves up, not to boast that we got it all together, no, but we do it to please, to care for, to love, to minister to our neighbor for their good, to build them up in Christ, to show them that love that Paul describes in 1 Corinthians 13 that's kind, it's patient, that doesn't keep account of wrongs, a love that never fails, the love that we're called to have, to display. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you so much for your word, a word that, God, at times it's hard when we read words like we read this morning of this obligation that we as your followers have to bear with others and the failings of others, Lord, realizing that we start with our own heart and recognize our own failings and our own sin and our own weakness, then we're able to see others through a different lens and minister and care and, yes, even speak the truth in love with a redemptive purpose, and then to come together as broken people to worship you and to glorify you. God, make us and guide us to be more faithful and more loving and kind. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, and may our response today be to go out today, go out this week, and think of those around us, maybe some that we've already sort of pushed aside because of things in their life or something they've done or said or because of some disagreement, but that we would see them through Christ's eyes and minister in a different way. God bless. David.
I invite you to stand and to join as we sing our last song. May this be our prayer and our goal for this week. Make me a servant.
Make me your servant, humble and meek. Lord, let me lift up those who are weak. And may the prayer of my heart always be, make me a servant, make me a servant, make me a servant today.
Dr. McNeil, we thank you very much for sharing the word with us. Please remember to keep Mike in your prayers as he recovers from surgery, to lift up one another in prayers as well. Now go and be blessed as the body of Christ in the world at work. Amen.